Father right now. I said he's worthy to be praised from the rising of the sun to the going down of the same. His name is to be praised. I said, come on, give God the praise. Happy, amen. Does anybody want to help me praise Jesus? Anybody want to help me lift up the name of Jesus? Come on. Come on. God's been too good to you. God has blessed us and kept us throughout this pandemic. God has kept us and given us the activity of our limbs. I don't know about you, but I come to give God the praise. I don't know what you come to do, but I come to give him the praise. I come to give him the glory. I come to lift him up, but he's been good to me. I said, has he been good to you? Those of you who are out there on YouTube, you're out there on Facebook, you're worshiping right now. I hope you're giving God the praise. But God has been good to you. God has blessed us. We could have been consumed already, but because he allowed us to have the activity of our limbs, you ought to say right now, if you come to church, you ought to just go ahead and have some church. Hallelujah. Bless his holy name. Yeah, come on. Won't you help me lift the name of Jesus up? It ain't nothing but a praise party. Just a praise party. You could have been dead and gone, but he made old death behave. And since he made old death behave, you ought to shout unto the glory of God. I said he's worthy. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. We're thankful that you've tuned in to our live broadcast right here at Bethesda Missionary Baptist Church. We're thankful to be in the house of the holy, the Amen Arena, the company of the committed. We are the regiment of the redeemed. God has been good to us. And because he's been good to us, we're glad to be able to come to you in your homes, wherever you are, to give God the praise and glory on this Sunday morning. We're going to get started and open up this morning. We're excited and we're delighted. As a matter of fact, I'll say it like I always say, I'm peacock proud and hyena happy to be in the house of the Lord. God has blessed us with so many other opportunities, open door to do ministry, which you'll hear about a little bit later on. But at this time right now, I'm going to ask that Minister Courtney Johnson will come with our scripture, prayer, and some words of exhortation at this time. Amen.
I check. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. You can continue praising him if you want to, because it's a beautiful day. We praise the Lord. I came with two scriptures today, one from Psalms 35 and the other one from Nehemiah 8:10. And the Psalms read, weeping may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning. And Nehemiah, the joy of the Lord is my strength.
Nehemiah.
And okay. Joy is a spiritual experience. I want to remind us of living in a personal relationship with a personal God whose very nature and identity is the infinite goodness. And I just want to, going out into my weeks, come back and just thank God for today. And the way we started today just fills me up with his spirit, with his joy. And I try to walk in and remind in these times and things that we're going through, part of our children in the body of Christ should show that joy to one another. It should be seen on your faces, it should be seen in your countenance, and it is of God. You should not have no one take it from you. And then as I see it as a weakness in some that walk around with their head, I ask them to be encouraged as we go through these trying times and that we continue to lift one another up and love one another up and press forward. And we bow our heads, I pray. In Jesus' almighty name, I come before you, God, humbly just saying thank you for another wonderful day, Father God, for another finished week, Father God, for another day of service, my almighty Father, Father. I thank you for those that were able to attend within the church, Father God, as well as the watchers that see, Father God, that we continue to lift your name up and we shout for joy and the joy that comes from you. We thank you, Lord. I thank you that it's yours to give and that it's no one to take from me, Father God. Your salvation, Father God, your son who died for us, Father God. I come before you first thanking you for that, for loving us, Father God. I come before you asking you to forgive us of the things that we have done that may not have been pleasant in thy eye this week, Father God. And we put those things before you and just ask that you forgive us, Father God. We ask that you would continue to help those that are in this fight for these COVID thing that we're having, Father God, that they stay strong and encouraged, Father God, that the churches would reopen their doors so that fellowship is more and more, as you have always had it to be, Father God. For we just thank you for that, Father God. I come before you, not knowing what all need, Father God, but knowing that you are a provider for us all, Father God. And let those needs be placed before you, Father God, that we know that our help comes from you, Father. We thank you again for this service today. And I pastor that your word go forth strong within him and the word that delivers this word, Father God. But again, we just come praising you, Lord, as we started out, that we continue this day and continue through the rest of the week, Father God, saying hallelujah, God.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Father God, for what you are and what you have been and what you always will be, Father God. We praise you again in your son's name, Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. We thank Minister Courtney for that fervent prayer, words of exhortation, and certainty. God has been good to us, and we want to continue to give him the praise and give him the honor that he so richly deserves. Amen. We thank God. Amen. We're going to go ahead and get started. Amen. Have a little praise and worship here. Amen. We're going to ask, amen, Brother Harris, will you grab that mic and help me, amen, raise this. You know, we know that time is filled with swift transition. Amen. 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 Not on earth can move. We're going to build our hopes on things eternal. Hold to God's unchanging hand. Amen. Amen. So you can go ahead and get your mask down. Amen. So you can go ahead and help me with this song. Amen. Come on, put your hands together.
Well, time is filled with swift transition. We'll hold to God's unchanging hand.
First verse, come on, time.
Time is filled with swift transition.
Put your eyes down.
Oh, oh, on earth unmovering. Oh, build your hopes on things eternal.
Come on.
We are hold to God's unchanging.
Everybody, come on. Trust in him. Trust.
Trust. And we will not leave you.
Whatsoever yours may bring,
whatsoever yours may bring.
If thy earthly,
if thy earthly friends forsaken, you ought to still more closely to him cling.
Come on, hold to his hand.
Well,
everybody,
hold to his.
Go ahead.
God's unchanging.
Come on.
To his hand. God's unchanging hand.
Come on.
Build your hopes on things eternal. You ought to hold to God's unchanging hand.
Third verse. Covet not, covet not.
Come not. This world's vain riches. Oh, that's so rapidly that, so rapidly decay.
Seek, come on,
seek to gain the heavenly treasures.
Oh,
forever pass away.
Let's get that going. Hold to his hand. Come on, brother.
Oh,
hand. Come on.
God's unchanging hand. To his hand. God's unchanging hand.
You ought to
build hopes on things eternal. To God's unchanging.
Fourth verse. When your journey is complete.
Again. Your journey is completed. If to God you have been true, if to God you have been true,
fair and bright the home in glory,
fed and right the home in glory. Your enraptured soul, your enraptured soul and beauty. Come on, everybody, will hold to his hand. Come on, God's unchanged. Oh, you are. Oh, and yeah, God's son, you got it. Go ahead.
You are a being
eternal. Oh, oh, to God. Come on, one more time. Come on, yeah, that's it. You got it. Hold to his hand. Come on. God's unchanging hand.
Oh, my brother.
Hold to his hand. God's unchanging hand. Feel your hope something eternal. You are the hope to God's unchanging hand. Your hope's on things eternal. You are hope to God's unchanging, unchanging hand. Yeah! Bless his holy name. I said, bless his holy name. Amen. Thank you. Amen, Brother Harris. Amen. Amen. If that didn't get your blood flowing, I don't know what will. Amen. We're excited to be in the house of the Lord once again on this Sunday morning. Amen. We're excited about the word. Amen. I got my friend and brother, amen, all the way from New Jersey. Amen. Amen. New York. Amen. Remind me of your church name, Living New Light. New Light. Pastor Leroy Mitchell is here. Amen. I'm excited. So before we go into the word this morning, he's here. Amen. I want him to come and have a few words this morning. Special words. We want to do I think he has something he wanted to share, especially this morning, for just a few moments before we get into the word. So come on, give God a hand for the praise for Pastor Leroy Mitchell, New Life Church in New York. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Good morning, church. Come on. Good morning, church. This is a very good day. I'm glad to be here. Amen. This is my hometown.
Amen.
Amen. And I'm just glad to be here today. Amen. This is a very special day. We are very special people. And we need to act like it every day. Amen. And this is a very special day right here. Amen. Thank God for this great man. And thank God for all of you. Come on, put your hands together. Let's just liven it up just a little bit. Amen. Because he did say what, two or three are? He did say that, didn't he? If two or three, and it's more than two or three in here, it's a lot of us. We can make a whole lot of noise. And there are some people sitting beside you, you just can't see them with your physical eyes. Are y'all hearing me? There are some people sitting next to you, on both sides of you, you just can't see them with these eyes. Next to you, standing up too, giving praise. But we just can't see them now. Amen? So we thank God. At this time, listen, I want to ask my a cousin of mine. She is my most favorite cousin in the whole wide world. Her name is Barbara Flakes, and I call her Sweetie. Yeah. I want to ask her if she could come up for a minute.
Amen. Amen. Come on. Amen.
I want to ask the pastor, could he grab that and he's going to read that.
Amen. 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 It's my pleasing privilege to read this, and I thank God for Pastor Mitchell. Amen. Thought it well. This is to, as he called her Sweetie, I call her Sister Flake, Dr. Flake. Amen. She's an educator. She's a woman of God. It says, this is what it says. The Bible lives in Barbara. That's what it, people tell on themselves when they seek God's advice. People tell on themselves by the way they live their life. Barbara, a people-friendly woman from the bottom of her heart. Barbara, a faithful steward
and a woman of God. A woman who always have a smile on her face. A woman who is genuinely generous to the human race. She's a family oriented and hold her family close and dear. Oh yes. A woman with a kind heart and a listening ear. Yes, yes. She attends to the homeless. Yes, she does. And their needs. Always taking time for a kind word and plenty of food to feed. Hallelujah. She's an advocate of the incarcerated, the downtrodden, the heavy burden. She's a woman after our own heart, and that's for certain. Barbara, a beautiful black woman, by the way that she speaks, a beautiful black woman by the friends that she seeks. Yes. Barbara, you told on yourself in such a positive and a spiritual way. By the life you live and letting God lead you each and every day. To God be the glory for a life well lived and well loved. Barbara, may God's grace, mercy, favor, and peace keep flowing from above. For every tree is known by its own fruit. Luke chapter 6 verse 44. Be blessed. This is Pastor Leroy Mitchell. Amen. Amen. Come on, come on. Give God a hand clap of praise. Amen. 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 Come on, you can do better than that. Come on. Amen. Amen. Come on, come on, come on, come on. Amen. 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 We thank God. Thank you, Pastor Mitchell. You know, my Mama Rita, that's my grandmother, she's gone on to be with the Lord. She often would tell us children, she would say, it's nice to be nice, and it's good to be good. And she also would tell us to be sweet and to always, we're beautiful, but she said, and would tell us not to be ugly. And she wasn't talking about on the outside, she was talking about on the inside. Don't be ugly on the inside. And so I'm thankful that to have Dr. Barbara Flake as a woman of God, certainly a friend to so many. And so she is exemplifies. And I thank God for her because I've seen her continue to, she's not satisfied for the status quo. She's not satisfied. And so it's a great example to keep growing. Keep growing over all of these years. God has blessed me to be the under-shepherd here. I mean, I've seen her. She was doing great work when I got here, but she is just continuing to go higher and higher. And so I thank God for her. Amen. Come on, give God a hand clap of praise. Amen. 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 But I don't know about you, but I'm excited. We're going to go a step further. Amen. I do want to give a plug out. And just yesterday, Pastor Mitchell and those of us, let me give a shout out unto our in-house cares ministry. Amen. Thank God for Brother Philip Brewster and Brother Al Hagen. And come on, give God a hand clap of praise, man. They broke away from their jobs in order to be able to pick up some food, some things that would be helpful to our community, for our members. I mean, they ran over here, and thank God for Brother Butts and Brother Harris and some others were out here. Brother Danny was out here. Amen. And so we know that here at Bethesda, we God has blessed us to do a lot in the community. He's going to continue to give us open door to do that. He's given us that kingdom territory. Brother Harris was here. And so that kingdom territory is that we would not only bless those who are in our community in the city, but also bless the Bethesda house. Because charity starts at home and then it spreads abroad. So remember, many of our members who were able to come out and take advantage of those who are in need of some of the food that we had, and then we were able to deliver some out
And so we're thankful for that. So I do want to, again, make this announcement that on Wednesday, we're going to be doing a drive-through food giveaway. A drive-through food giveaway for the city, anybody who needs it, amen. And we're going to give it out until it's gone. And stay tuned for other opportunities for us to bless the city. You don't have to get out of your car just like we did it before. Just drive through, and we'll have someone to just put it in your trunk, and you just keep on going. And our members who come to help, just as they are right now, that have a mask on, that you have a mask on, and we have some gloves on, and we're thanking God for our custodial staff and the persons of Sister, amen, Cook and Brother Joe Cook, amen. We thank God for Sister Bernice Cook, and our facilities continue to be sanitized. Just give it a little station identification, because some have asked me at times, well, Pastor Graham, I know that you all are on YouTube, you're on Facebook Live, and you're out there on social media. We are, but also our doors remain open for those who would want to come into the sanctuary. But I do want to remind you that we're coming in to the sanctuary wearing a mask, amen. Put your mask on and social distance apart. Those who are the same household, you can sit on the same seat or pew together. So we are adhering to the CDC guidelines. And so we want to be sure you understand and know that. So when you come in, we want to make it be safe. And so I just want you to know that. Again, we thank God for each of you who are continuing to follow us. Well, I don't know about you, but I'm ready for the word. I'm excited about this word that God has given to me on this morning. We are in this series that God has been, God has been showing up and showing out. I also want to plug, also, we thank God for Covenant of Faith Church and Apostle Brenda Jefferson and Pastor James Jefferson. These last couple of Tuesday nights, and certainly Dr. Flake, amen, instrumental. I've been sharing with them in their kingdom empowerment on each Tuesday for the last couple of Tuesdays, and Lord said the same, I'll be there with them. Again, Dr. Lou Turner also on that panel, talking about kingdom empowerment, because we got to have the right mindset. Dr. Lou Turner's, plug her book, Having a Kingdom Mindset. And that's what we need, to have a kingdom mindset. It goes right in hand with God. We serve the same God. We're in the spirit of God. God just put this together. The series that we are in, claiming your kingdom territory. And so we're continuing to do that. So tune in to Kingdom Empowerment on the Covenant of Faith on Tuesday. You can also pull it up on the Facebook. And so we're just excited and thankful about that. And we're going to get a little help, amen, from one of our gospel artists, amen. Amen, our gospel artists, we don't own the rights to the music, but we're excited about this word, this song, amen, brother, amen, it's worship, amen, experience, amen, Sister Tasha Cobb Leonard, and so we want you to take a listen as we prepare for worship on this Sunday, for the word, rather, on this Sunday. We don't own the rights to the music, but we certainly love it.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
We stand in awe.
We stand in awe of you, God. We stand in awe of you, God. Oh, God.
We stand in awe.
Lift up those hands. Lift up those hands. We in awe of you, God. Mighty God that you are. Oh, God.
Yes, we do.
Go on and worship him. Worship him right now, God. Worship him. We're in awe of you, God. Your majesty, your power, and your glory. We stand in awe of you this morning. Oh, God. Oh, God. Oh, God, the eternal one. The self-existent one.
Not by might.
Yes, Jesus.
Not by power.
Yes, God.
By your spirit, God. Send your spirit, God.
Hallelujah. Amen. 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 Come on, give God a hand clap of praise. Amen. Amen. It's by his spirit, by his power, not by might, not by our power, but certainly by his spirit, saith the Lord. Amen. This coronavirus, any other pandemic that we're dealing with, is not by might, not by our power, but by his spirit, saith the Lord. Amen. Amen. Well, I'm excited about this word. Come on and stand to your feet. Amen. As we get into this word, those of you who are join us on Facebook Live and YouTube, amen, where you are in your living room and your, whether it be in your washroom, your bedroom, wherever you are, your den, some may be in their cars. Amen. Hope you, if you're in your car driving, don't be on Facebook. Just listen to us. Amen. We thank God. Amen for this word and this series that God has given to us. Amen. With your Bibles in your care, repeat after me. This is my Bible. God's holy word. It's a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. I receive it with my hearing. I believe with my head. I hide it in my heart. I am what it says I am. I can have what it says I can have. I can do what it says I can do. Therefore, today, I will listen to Bible preaching and Bible teaching. Today, I will be a hearer and a doer of the word. Today, I will hide it in my heart. I'll also practice it in my home. And if you agree with that affirmation, why don't you say amen? It is so. We do thank God for each of you, our Father's children, who are here in the beautiful sanctuary here at Bethesda. Missionary Baptist Church, which I affectionately call the House of the Holy, the Amen Arena. We are the regiment of the redeemed, the company of the committed. Thank God for those who are joining us on your homes, wherever you may be, on YouTube and Facebook Live. We're excited and delighted that you have chosen to worship with us on this Sunday morning. And we hope that you'll tell a neighbor, tell a friend, amen, that the feast of the Lord is going on at Bethesda. Amen. Amen. I'll say in more ways than one, not only your spiritual, but we got some physical food that we've been giving out. Amen. That we share with you. We also thank God for those of you who join us each Wednesday for our call to God prayer line led by Reverend Marilyn J. Peoples. And we thank God for her. You can call in to our prayer line. Prayer line number is, again, on our Facebook page. And we'll also share it with you again before we close out our live streaming on this morning. But also, I want to invite you to be a part of the pastor's prayer time early in the morning. Amen. Early in the morning. Boy, we had a great time in prayer on this Sunday morning. We're praying for world peace. We're praying for the community peace. And we're praying for families. We're praying for the church. We're praying for ministry. We're praying for marriages. We're praying for all these things early in the morning, 7 days a week, from 5 a.m. to 5:30. You can call in to the same number that you call into the Call to God prayer line. You call into that number. I will already be praying. Just mute your phones, and we'll be praying, amen, to 5:30 every morning, amen, that God sends. But also, we thank God for, again, our Bible study. Yours was joining us. We're still talking about experiencing God. And when you're talking about kingdom living, you're talking about experiencing God to his fullest. You know, a lot of times we walk, and we are Christians, we're believers, but we're not really experiencing what it is to have a kingdom mindset. So tune in on Wednesday at 6 o'clock, amen, a Bible study fellowship, amen, at that same time. We thank God for you. We're a church that is Christ-led in. We believe our Christian courtesy is so contagious. If you'll come, you'll want to come back again and again and again and again. We're excited to be a blessing to you. We pray that God continue to bless us so that we would be a blessing to somebody else. Amen. Well, I'm going to lift up this word. Amen. If you don't mind this morning, Joshua, the third chapter. Joshua, the third chapter. And I'm going to commence my Bible reading, verses 1 through 6, and then I'm going to jump down to verses 14 and 17. But I would encourage you, while we're preaching through this series, that God has given us the unction and the power and the permission and given us preaching privilege and power to read Joshua. Joshua has much to say to us in this day and time. Read this whole passage of Scripture, but due to the length of the passage and the limitations on our time, we're going to read these verses into your hearing. And when you've found it, I'm reading from the English Standard Version, the English Standard Version. And so if in case you're reading from the King James, NIV, New King James, it doesn't matter. I assure you, it is the same word. Amen? Amen. Amen. Joshua, the third chapter. Amen. Give you time to get to it. Third chapter. Amen. Beginning with verse number 1. And this is how it reads. Then Joshua rose early in the morning, and they set out from Shittim, and they came to the Jordan, he and all the people of Israel, and lodged there before they passed over. At the end of 3 days, the officers went through the camp and commanded the people, "As soon as you see the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord your God being carried by the Levitical priest, then you shall set out from your place." Notice that he said, "Then you will set out from your place and follow it." Y'all see that? "Yet there shall be a distance," get this, "between you and it, about 2,000 cubits in length. Do not come near it, in order that you may know the way you shall go, for you have not passed this way before." Yeah, yeah. "Then Joshua said to the people, 'Consecrate yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do wonders among you.'" Let me just park there parenthetically. I hope while you've been sheltering in place, while you've been shut in, while you've been a social distance, that you have been preparing yourself, that you've been consecrating yourself. Yeah, yeah. Verse 6 says, "And Joshua said to the priest, 'Take up the Ark of the Covenant and pass on before the people.' So they took up the Ark of the Covenant and went before the people." I'm going to drop down to verse 14 and 17. "So when the people set out from their tents to pass over the Jordan with the priests were bearing the Ark of the Covenant before the people. And as soon as those bearing the ark had come as far as the Jordan, and the feet of the priest bearing the ark were dipped in the brink of the water." Now the Jordan overflows all its banks throughout the time of harvest. This was the time of harvest. "The waters coming down from above stood and rose up in a heap very far away at the Adam, the city of Adam, that is beside Zarethan. And those flowing down toward the sea of Arabah, the salt sea, were completely cut off. And the people passed over opposite Jericho. Now the priest bearing the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord stood firmly on dry ground in the midst of the Jordan." Now, I'm going to get you this picture. They were standing on dry ground out in the midst of where the Jordan was. "And all of Israel was passing over on dry ground until all the nation finished passing over the Jordan." That's all. Now, I want to tag this text this morning, "How to Get Past Your Jordan." Amen. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of Almighty God. This sermon series, A Kingdom Territory, and God had given the children of Israel this territory. This was not territory. This was not a land. Canaan was not something that they had to fight for. They would not have to pursue it. But God said, I gave it to them. But God gave some specific instructions. Let me just rehearse just very briefly. We talked about how God had given them that territory. God gave Joshua, who was a military-minded man of God, instructions that were certainly strange, I'm certainly sure, to Joshua, because he didn't tell him to use any shields, any swords, any spears, but he gave him specific instructions, Pastor Mitchell, Dr. Flay. He gave him some specific instructions that march around the city six times for 6 days, and then on the seventh day, march, amen, seven times. That's 13 times. And don't rush the city, but just blow a loud shout, and the walls came tumbling down. But we preached on last Sunday about the scarlet thread or a scarlet cord, a Rahab, a woman of ill repute, a woman of red light district, a prostitute, a harlot. And let us know that you don't know who that person is. You don't know what God has placed in them, because she had evidently been with God, and because she kept and came in league with the spies and helped them when that wall came tumbling down. Everything but the Rahab's house, who lived in the wall, came tumbling down because she had trusted in the God that she had heard about. Oh, come on here. Is anybody trusted in the God that I've heard? Have you heard about God? Have you heard about his exploits? Have you heard about how he's a burden bearer? Have you heard about how he's a heavy load sir? Have you heard about how he is a battle axe in the time of trouble? How he's a leaning? Have you heard about God? She had heard about him. And my brothers and sisters, during this pandemic, during all of the evil that's been going on, the wickedness in high places, we want to live our lives as kingdom-minded saints to let the world know, so that they can hear about the God that the people in Bethesda, amen, and I hope those other churches who are open in the name of Jesus, that hear about the God and want to come to get to know him like Rahab. Well, on this Sunday morning, we're talking about how to get past Jordan, because they didn't have to fight to get into Canaan, but they had some obstacles. We talked to you about how Canaan was not a depiction of heaven, although some seem to think it is, but Canaan represents the promised land. But Canaan certainly can't be a representative of the heaven, because when we get to heaven, there's not going to be any more battles. There's not going to be any more fights. But Canaan, when they got into Canaan, just like you and I, when we go into Canaan, there's still some obstacles that we've got to deal with. You're going to pray with me this morning. Because of their unbelief, Israel had been sentenced to wander in the wilderness. They did that for 40 years. Those years have now expired, and the children of Israel are poised to enter into Canaan land. They are ready to claim their inheritance in the land of promise. But however, before they can enter Canaan, they must first get past one final major obstacle. And I'm talking to somebody, speaking to somebody. Maybe you've been walking with God, and you received what God, you heard what God has told you. But God, maybe there's something that's standing in your way, an obstacle. I want to help you out, because all of us have our own Jordans that we got to get past. The major obstacle, the Jordan River. Now, normally, this would have not presented much of a problem, because since the Jordan was only 100 feet wide in Gilgal, where they crossed, can I teach it before I preach it? However, it seems that God always does things in such a way that no man can boast of having done them on their own. You see, if we could do everything on our own, we wouldn't need God. You see, God allows us to have to go up the hills and the mountains and the valleys, but because it didn't come to stop us. It didn't stop. It come to help us to in order that we might understand that we need the Lord. This crossing would be no exception. You see, God brought them to the Jordan River at a time of harvest. You read over chapter 4, verse 15, talks about it. Those who have been there and maybe in harvest time tell us that the Jordan swells to an impassable width during harvest time. It's over a mile wide of the Jordan River. It's over 50 times wider than it normally would have been. When the Israel arrived, there were no way they could cross that river on their own. They need supernatural help. And my brothers and sisters, whether you recognize it or realize it, we need some supernatural help. I know the doctors and the scientists, they're working fast. I heard about it. They said they were in warp speed trying to come up with an antivirus, a vaccine. But I wish I could speak them to them right now. But tell them, matter of fact, I'll let you know that I don't care what the doctors are doing. I don't care what the scientists are doing. But you're going to need the help of the Lord. You're going to need supernatural power. And even when the vaccine comes about, it's not going to be because of the intelligentsia of the, and I'm not trying to disrespect scientists. I'm not trying to disrespect those who are healthcare providers and doctors, and they're intelligent. But my brothers and my sisters, I'm praying every morning. I'm praying. I know I believe the prayers, the Bible says, of the righteous avail much. So church, we got to pray. God has placed us here in this earth realm. Why do you think that the church has not been raptured out already? If it had not been for the church, if it had not been for the believers, this world spinning, my brothers and sisters, and wickedness and running the streets and like a mad dog, don't you know this world would have already been gone? But God left his church, those kingdom-minded citizens, here to pray for this world. Here, my brothers and my sisters, they had to recognize that if they're going to receive their inheritance, it was going to take some supernatural help. If mama's going to get well, it's going to take supernatural help. If brother and sister are going to turn to the Lord, it's going to take some supernatural help. The songwriter Tashikov Leonard said, not by might, not by power, but by my spirit, saith the Lord. Soul's going to be saved. It's going to take some supernatural help. You see, my brothers and sisters, the picture, the greatest inheritance imaginable sitting out before a person, the longing of the inheritance gnawing away at the person's heart. The inheritance in his, it has been promised and guaranteed. Can you imagine? It's been guaranteed. I ain't talking about something that might be. That's what the Bible means when it talks about hope. We don't hope for hope that we have in Christ is not something that might be. But our hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' love and his righteousness. We dare not trust the sweetest frame, but is anybody going to wholly lean on Jesus' name, on Christ, the what solid rock I stand? All of the ground is sinking sand. This inheritance is that it has been promised and guaranteed, and the person will receive this inheritance. But obstacles and barriers stand in the way, and they must be removed before he can receive the promised inheritance. This is the picture, my brothers and sisters. I just want to, you don't mind if I want to paint the picture here. Inheritance of the Israelites were to receive this inheritance of the promised land. Ever since the birth of the Israelites that began their forefather Abraham, God had promised the inheritance of the land to his people for hundreds of years. And I want to tell somebody, I know it seems like it's been a long time since you've been waiting for what God promised you, but my brothers and sisters, be not weary in well-doing. In due season, you shall reap a just reward if you do what? Faint not. The promised land and the great hope it offered were the major theme and teaching of the Israelites. Most of it, not all Israelites gripped by deep-seated longing, but the glorious inheritance promised them by God. But now, finally, long-awaited crossing the Jordan River was to take place. God's people were to enter the promised land. The inheritance for which they had so long hoped was finally become their possession. Can't you see it? Can you imagine? They had been wandering for 40 years. Generations had died out because in the beginning, the multitude, they believed in the evil report when they went over and saw and spied how good the land was and saw that it was flowing with milk and honey. And they came back, only Joshua and Caleb came back with a good report. They said, yeah, we see the giants over there. We see all of that over there, but we're well able to overcome it. But the multitude of the people, they believed in the report of the other majority report. And I want to tell somebody, just because everybody seemed to be saying, don't believe it, but everybody says, believe in the word of God, because they that be with us, he said, it's more than they that be with them. He recognized, my brothers and sisters, they said, we look like grasshoppers in our sight, and we look like grasshoppers in their sight. And my brothers and my sisters, they not only only looked at themselves at what the giants saw them as, but they also saw themselves. Can I ask you a question this morning? How do you see yourself? How are you seeing yourself? Are you seeing yourself as above and not beneath, a lender and not the borrower? Are you seeing yourself as highly favored? Are you seeing yourself as a kingdom of kids? Are you seeing yourself as that you above and not beneath? Are you seeing yourself as God sees you? My brothers and sisters, don't believe the hype of the world. And so, my brothers and sisters, but because they didn't believe, God has sustained Joshua and Caleb, and they had been out there for 40 years wondering, but now, here was a generation. Here was a generation that was ready to obey God. Each of us have our Jordans that we got to face. This morning, I want to talk and lift up a few points. I'm going to soon sit down. I'm going to get in my seat. I promise you, I will. Allow me to show you from chapters 3 and 4 of our text this morning, this pericope of God. Joshua talks about how to get past your Jordan. The first thing I want to lift up to you this morning of how you're going to get past your Jordan, if you're going to get past it, recognize that there is a message to consider. That's the first thing I want to say to you in verses 1 through 13. Matter of fact, deals with this message. There's a message to consider. You see, we've got to consider the message that God has given us. He's given us a message of reconciliation. Quite prominent in the account of Israel's crossing of the Jordan were the priests of Israel who carried the Ark of the Covenant. Read the text. I hope you got your Bibles. So the priests carrying the Ark led the Israelites to the Jordan River. They did not, however, lead them across the Jordan. Did you hear what I said? Right. Therefore, they stopped in the midst of the Jordan. Yeah. For they stopped in the midst of the Jordan and waited there until everyone had finished crossing. They followed instructions. And many times, my brothers and my sisters, the reason why we haven't gotten past Jordan, because nobody wants to obey. Nobody wants, people, they want to do it their own way. Everybody has a way of doing it. But the priests were under direct command, get this, of Joshua in the venture of crossing the Jordan. Good followership makes good leadership. You see, here the people, the priests were willing to follow the commands of Joshua because God had placed Joshua, the general there, the man of God there, to give the instructions that had come from God, and they followed his instructions to the T. They made no movement until Joshua commanded them to commence. They didn't start trying to do with their own thing. They didn't start talking about, I don't read anywhere in the text where they said, well, Joshua, what do you mean? Why can't we go all the way across? Or why do we got to stand here? But God told them to say, listen, you take the ark, you go across. And here we particularly want to look at the two significant things that they did as Joshua's command, which speaks commendably of the excellent commitment to the work of God. Are you hearing me? We got to have some excellency in the people of God, the kingdom of God. They were committed here. These two actions concern stepping in the Jordan and staying in the Jordan. Let me show you what I'm talking about. First of all, they were instructed, the priest was said, step into the Jordan. Now, mind you, this Jordan River, over a mile wide, can you imagine? It was raging, it was flooding. And he says, I tell you what I want you to do, priest. Put your foot in the water. Now, common sense sometimes, in which my brothers and sisters would tell us, well, wait a minute, God, you're going to part that river? You're going to part it? Don't you want to wait and let the river back up? But no, the priest that bear the ark, God told Joshua to command them, saying, when you are come to the brink of the water, you shall stand still. Now, the priest carrying the ark led the people to the Jordan River, and when they had come to the river's edge, the priest kept going for a short ways, and they kept going until they actually stepped in the Jordan River on the brink of the river. And then Joshua informs the people, listen to it, as soon as the soles, hear what it said, as the soles of the feet of the priest bear the ark, the Lord said, shall rest in the waters of Jordan. The waters of Jordan shall be cut off, and the waters that come down from above. The priest walking into the Jordan was an act of faith. I believe that's what my mother used to say when she meant. I didn't understand quite sure what she was saying, but she said, son, if you make one step, God will make two. In other words, she was telling me, you do what you can do, and then God will do what he can do. You see, there are some things that you and I can do. But then what we can't do, God does. What they could do was put their foot in the river. What they could do is follow the instructions of Joshua. And so as they followed the instructions of Joshua, God had promised to part the Jordan when the priest who carried the ark walked into it. But the human reasoning, it looked stupid to walk into the flooded waters of the Jordan, especially when they were carrying the most precious cargo, mind you. They had the Ark of the Covenant. These priests were sworn to take care of the ark. And they were sworn because the Ark of the Covenant represented the presence of Almighty God where he dwelled. And not anybody could just touch that Ark of the Covenant. And if you would touch it and you were not consecrated, if you had not been commanded, then you would fall dead. But they were told to go with the Ark of the Covenant, carry it, and put their foot in the Jordan. Now we must learn today that God, through the world and carnal reason, perceives it is foolishness, and the others have said we must get our feet wet. Come on, yeah. You know, maybe that's what I mean. You see, we got to learn how to get our feet wet. We got to get our feet wet. What I mean by that, get our feet wet when it comes to having faith in God. You not gotten your feet wet? You got to, the Bible says that faith is the substance of things hoped for. It's the evidence of things that you cannot see. But a lot of people don't want to get their feet wet. A lot of people don't want to trust in the Lord, love in the Lord with all of their heart. Lean not to their own understanding, but in all of their ways acknowledge him, knowing that he will direct their path. Stand in the Jordan after the Jordan was parted. They were told to stand there. When the waters are cut off, the priests were instructed to march down into the riverbed. But when they got there, the priests that bear the ark stood in the midst of the Jordan until everything was finished and that the Lord commanded Joshua. I want to tell somebody, don't stop right now. You got to finish strong. If you're working, keep on working. If you're serving, keep on serving. If you're marching, keep on marching. If you're praying, keep on praying. Don't stop right now. You know how I like to say it. Don't stop. Get it, get it. Don't stop. Get it, get it. Put some Holy Ghost in it. You got to keep on going. And keep on standing and stand still until you see the salvation of the Lord. This duty of the priest required a considerable commitment. It would take upwards of a day for Israelites to cross over at a rate of 2,000 people per minute. It was going to take an 8 hours. This was over 1 million people that were coming through the Jordan. This wasn't just a small company. And so that meant that it was an endurance that it took. You see, my brothers and sisters, I've heard many people say, well, when is the COVID-19 pandemic going to be over? Well, my brothers and my sisters, we're crossing over Jordan. We're crossing through the midst of this pandemic. We're crossing right now. And I know sometimes the day seems long and so dark the night, the stars in the sky, but we know that Jesus has got us in the midst of it. So I want to tell the people of God, pastors and preachers and teachers, keep on preaching. And when the people start to move through and cross over their Jordan, stand still, keep on standing so that they'll recognize and see that God's people are still in the midst of the waters. You see, this added to many people who crossed over the Jordan. This was a great multitude. Not only the people, there was livestock. There was all kinds of things that they brought with them, and this required much patience. It requires stamina. And so we gotta have stamina. We gotta be patient. We gotta be long-suffering. But the message that we have to consider involves a challenge. It was challenging. I don't wanna paint this picture as something that's easy to do. Because what you got to face, the obstacle, is a challenging message. It's a challenging message that he put out here. Notice that the Ark of the Covenant is mentioned some 7 times in chapter number 3. If you peruse that pericope, the Ark, you remember, was the special piece of the tabernacle furniture that symbolized the presence of the power of God. And when the Ark was in the Holy of Holies, the glory of God rested upon it, and it was a dwelling place of God. It's an Israel. It represented God's presence. So the covenant, it was mentioning, and it continued to talk about it. There is a valuable spiritual lesson here in this passage for you and you and I. We would do well when we face times of crisis. Get this. For when we need direction and life to learn sensitive in the movement of the Lord and around it, it's a fact that God loves you and that he will show up in the midst of what you're doing. I don't care what you're going through. Mother's sick, father's sick, accident, someone died, bereavement. He's right there in the midst of your situation. Come here, three Hebrew boys. You see, he might not stop the fire, but he's able to get in the fire with you. And I don't know about you, my brothers and sisters, as long as he's with me. You see, though I go through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil. Why? Because thou art with me. You see, when you got the presence of God, you got the power of God. When you got the power of God, you got the protection of God. When you got the protection of God, you got the providence of God. So here, it was teaching us here to recognize, to watch God, no matter what you're doing. Peter learned that. He was out on the water when Jesus told him, he said, if that's you, Lord, let me come on out on the water. And Peter was doing pretty good. He was watching Jesus. He was not paying attention to the, he was not watching the waves. He was not watching that was lapping about his feet because he was standing on stuff that he was afraid of and nobody else could walk on. As long as he watched God, as long as he watched Jesus. Not only watch Jesus, but also watch God, but you got to follow God. You see, a lot of times people are watching God, but they're not following. We got to follow him. We used to sing a song about it, Brother Harris, when I was growing up. Lead me, guide me along the way. Lord, if you lead me, I shall not stray. Lord, let me walk each day with thee. Lead me, guide me. We got to follow God. Notice in the text, I'm not making it up, when it told us that leave your place and go after it. And what this is saying, not just geography, but we got to leave the place of our mindset. A lot of times the reason why we are not crossing and getting the message, because we want to stay where we are and think we're going to go where God is leading us. We've been teaching, experiencing God. And one of the things, one of the realities of experiencing God, in order to follow God, you got to make major adjustments. You got to make some adjustments. You got to leave where you are. I don't care. You say, well, I got a quick temper. Well, you got to leave that temper behind. You got to leave where you are. You know, when people mess with me, I got to get them. You got to leave where you are. If you've been used to doing one thing one way, you got to leave that mindset and get the kingdom mindset. You got to follow God, leave your place, and go after him. Is anybody willing to chase after God? This may require you to leave your comfort zone. Israel, about to follow the ark through the river, was over a mile wide. They had to leave their comfort zone. During the midst of this pandemic, God is calling his church to leave your comfort zone. We were comfortable gathering up in the sanctuary. We were comfortable when we all gathered together and see everybody. But we had to leave our comfort zone. There's some who had not, if you hadn't been online and hadn't been served and getting out and increasing your digital footprint, you had to leave your comfortability. You got to go out and go into some deep waters. I'm in Bible territory. You remember Jesus was out there and Peter, an experienced fisherman, and he had been out there fishing all night long. And Jesus says, he said, have you got any meat? He said, I've been fishing. I'm an experienced fisherman. I know where to drop my net. I've been used to doing this. I know what I'm doing. I know how to fish. And some of us are saying right now, I know how to preach. I know how to pastor. I know how to deacon. I know how to serve. But he said, Jesus told Peter, he said, cast your net on the other side. Let down your net. And God is saying to us right now, are you willing to follow me? Are you willing to forsake your mind? And listen, Paul says, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. You see, Jesus had a saving mind. Jesus had a selfless mind. Jesus had a secure mind. And so he told him to drop his net. And he dropped his net. And you know the end of the story. There was such a great catch of fish that the net began to break. All because he left his own place. He left what he knew. See, there's a lot of stuff, you know, when we do teaching and training with the Arkansas Department of Human Service, Division of Children and Family Services, where I work, we got some things that when we're trying to do something different, a new program that we're trying to implement. But problem is we got some people who have learned the old way of doing things. Did you hear what I said? They're so ingrained in their thoughts the way they used to do it. This is the way we did it. This is why. But now you're being taught to do it a different way. It's the same thing, but it's a different way. You see, God is still the same God. I hear you. Some people say, well, why are we changing that? God is still holy. God is still saving. God is still mighty. God is still powerful. But God has different methods. And so now you're called to do something different. And many people, that's why he says he's given us the keys to the kingdom. Thank you, Dr. Lou Turner. I'll give you a shout out with the keys. He said, because she gave us an illustration that you have a lot of keys sometimes. I got a lot of keys on my keychain, Dr. Mitchell. I'm going to just use right now. I got all these keys right here. I got all these keys on here, Brother Randolph. And at one time, all of these keys went to some door. They all did. They used them, but over time, we changed some stuff. Got the same doors back there. Got the same entranceway. But the old keys don't work anymore. And because I've kept the old keys on this key ring, what I have to do is go, let me go through here. And I'll be trying. And that's the picture of what some of us trying to do. We had keys in the world. It worked in the world. We had keys in our own old tradition, and they worked in the old tradition. But now God says, listen, if you want to get into the kingdom, come on here, you got to get the right key. So what I'm telling you, somebody, you got to take off the old keys, and because you find out, now you got just the keys that you need. Go into the kingdom, and you won't be confused because you got all these keys. You got to follow God. Follow and thank you, Holy Ghost. But then we got to watch God. We got to follow God, but then we got to honor God. The people were instructed by Joshua through the officer that there shall be a space between you and it about 2,000 cubits. That's about, in our distance that we know, that's about a little over half a mile. The Ark of the Covenant had to be about a little over half a mile out in front of the people. Now, a number of reasons are given by various commentators and theologians as to why the Israelites were to remain at a distance from the ark. Some say the distance was symbolic, Dr. Flake, representing the law, which was Israel was under. Don't have a problem with that. But some keep men at a distance from God because the law certainly does that, because the law is good, but it's a good schoolmaster. But God, the law still keeps men at a distance. Others say that a distance was necessary because the ark was holy. I don't have a problem with that, because you remember how God told Moses to take off his shoes because the ground you're standing on is holy ground. Still others say that the distance means we should not have an irreverent familiarity with the sacred things of God. All of these are good reasons, and they make logical, good instructive for us. But however, let's look at the text and let's focus on primarily upon the reason our text gives for the distance. You see, it says in the text that the reason for the Israelites were to be at a distance from the ark. Notice in the text, keep your finger and your eye in the text, and it says that they may know the way by which you must go. You see, they had to stand off at a distance because God wanted them to know. And see, it was over a million people. And if it was too close, some people would block the way that the ark was going. The Israelites needed to stay back enough so they could get a good view and a good perspective of where the ark was going. And furthermore, some crowd around the ark, a few would only be able to see the ark and see where it was going, and others wouldn't be able to see. You see, it was to be an orderly procession, not to be confused or disorderly in possession. The ark, therefore, needed to be out in front where folk could see it and could move in an orderly fashion. You see, God is not the author of confusion, but God is orderly in everything he does. A distance from God is not the lesson here. Not that we need to stay distant from God, but rather the lesson is one of discernment. God is not trying to hide. He's not a cosmic killjoy. He wants us to see him and see him very clearly and very plainly. You see, the Israelites were to be located in such a way that they could easily discern the leading of the ark. And secondly, the Israelites needed to be located in such a way that they did not hinder others from seeing the ark and knowing God's way. Come here. You see, sometimes, my brothers and sisters, if we're not careful, we will crowd around those and they're not able to see and discern what God is trying to do. God wants everybody to see which way he's going. And there's a lesson here for us as well. We must never be guilty of treating God like he's one of our buddies. He's a holy God. He's a reverent God. Yes, he is. I thank God for the message. Also, it involved a command. Did you hear what I said? Yes, next, the people were told, sanctify yourselves. You see that, don't you? Not making this up. It don't matter if I walk through it, do you? He says, sanctify yourself. Follow the commands of the Lord. If you and I ever expect to get past our Jordans, arise in our lives, we are going to have to learn that one of the first things we must do is examine our lives. Take an introspective look at you. Say, it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Not my brother, not my sister, but it's me, oh Lord. You see, Christian victory is a result, a lot of times, of our sin and our Lord's chastisement. Did you hear what I said? The Hebrew writer says, despise not the chastening of the Father. It's because God loves you that he chastens you. It's because if God loves him that he disciplines us. And so, therefore, we thank God for him chastening or disciplining us, and he commands us. But then the message involved not only a commandment, but it involves commitment. You see, Joshua said to the people of Israel, come here and listen to the words of the Lord your God in verses 9 and 10. And Joshua said, here is how you shall know that the living God is among you, and that he will without fail drive out before you the Canaanites and the Hittites and the Hivites and the Perizzites and the Girgashites and the Amorites and the Jebusites. Behold, the ark of the covenant of the Lord of the earth is passing over before you into the Jordan. And now therefore take 12 men from the tribes of Israel, from each tribe a man, and when the soles of the feet of the priests are bearing the ark of the Lord of the earth shall rest in the waters of the Jordan. The waters of the Jordan shall be cut off. You see, when we follow God's command, we are committed. A lot of folk are not committed. We can't get past our Jordan because we're not committed. Commitment, another good word for commitment is being consistent. If you want to be committed, you've got to be consistent. It takes, you got day after day. And some of us say, well, I went to church last Sunday, but then not because they're going to work, not because they can't make it, because some of the hindrance, but they just say, I don't want to go this Sunday. Well, I helped them last time when they were out serving. But I'll let somebody else go this time. They're just not consistent. You don't know when they're going to show up. You don't know when they're going to be there, because why? They are not consistent. They're not committed. A good definition for commitment and consistency I adopted years ago. It's not my own, but I adopted it. It's a good one. You've heard me say it over and over again. Commitment is doing what you said you would do long after the time has passed when you said you would do it. Let me say it one more time. Stop, pause, and rewind. Commitment is doing what you said you would do long after, B.B. King says, when the thrill is gone, that you had when you said you would do it. A lot of folks say, oh, yeah. Today in the crowd, pick me. I'll do it. Yeah. But then when time come, you can't find them. When time come, I got something I got to do. I forget. I got to go back and I got some work at home. And I think somebody calling me and I forget. You see what happened was. And you know how all of these excuses. We got all kinds of excuses because when you have determined that I'm going to do what I said I was going to do, the only way I don't do it is that I can't do it because something is stopping me. Either I'm sick, I can't make it, but you can show up, and that's commitment and consistency. You see, my brothers and sisters, he was calling for the priests to be committed and consistent because it was going to take a time for the people to cross over. We worry sometimes over tomorrow. Yet the Lord has said in Matthew 6:34, therefore do not be anxious about tomorrow, for tomorrow will be anxious for itself. Sufficient for the day of its trouble. A lot of times people are not consistent because they are worried about what's going to happen tomorrow. What if I can't do it? What if they won't go with me? What if I can't do what I said I was going to do? But the worry over material things Yet the Lord has promised in Matthew, I'm in Bible territory, 6 and 25. Therefore, I tell you, do not be anxious about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink. Know about your body, what you're going to put on it. It's not life more than food and the body more than clothing. Look at the birds of the air. The scripture says they neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns. But look at what our God says. Your heavenly Father feeds them, and they are not more valuable than they. We are more valuable than they. And some are worrying about facing various things in their lives. And yet the Lord has promised us to never leave nor forsake us. Be not dismayed, my brothers and my sisters. Whatever be tied, he will take care of you. Beneath his wings of love abide. Is anybody in the house of Bethesda? I know God said, he will take care of us. We worry so many things, yet the Lord tells us that all of our worrying, all is sin, and that all of our duty is to trust in him. And he's called us to trust in him. The bottom line, my brothers and my sisters, that Jesus is an all-powerful God. He's an all-knowing God. He's an all-present God. He knows what you are doing and going through. He knows every time and everything. He knows the end of a thing before it even gets started. But not only, my brothers and my sisters, is there a message here, but there's a miracle to consider. Because when God steps in, my brothers and sisters, be ready for a miracle. I don't know about you, but I agree with what the Clark sister sung a long time ago. I expect a miracle. Every day God will perform it. Is there anybody here expecting a miracle? Yes, there was a problem. Yes, my brothers and sisters, but there was a plan. I don't care what the problem is. I need you to know, my brothers and my sisters, God always has a plan. Yes, all things work together for the good of those who love God and for those who are called according to his purpose. God has a plan. Yes, he does. God has a plan for you to go through this coronavirus. God has a plan for you to get through your sickness. God has a plan for you to get through your trial. God has a plan for you to deal with your job. God has a plan for you to feed your family. And God has a plan for the kids to go back to school. Government may not have a plan. The school might not have a plan, but God has a plan. I come here on my way to heaven to announce to the world that he has a plan. If anybody know he's got a plan, he sits high and he looks low. But not only does he have a plan and purpose, but God, he's a performer. There is no secret what God can do. What he's done for others, he'll do the same thing for you. With arms wide open, he will pardon you. Anybody here love my Jesus? Is there anybody here love my Lord? Yeah, I don't mind telling the world I love him. He's my high tower. Yes, he is. He's the chief cornerstone that we have memorial to consider. But after the battle is over, after we make you throughout Jordan, don't forget what God has done. Yeah, yeah. I know he's all right. I said, I know he's all right. God has a purpose and God has a plan. Yes, he does. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah. Memorial, consider the message to consider. Understand that God has a way. He's got a plan. He's got a purpose. And I'm going to say this and I'm going to sit down in my seat. I promise you. The purpose of the memorial is that there may be a sign. See, God's got, see, there's folk coming on behind us. Children and grandchildren, great-grandchildren. And they don't want to know. Back in 2020, when the march, when they found out about the coronavirus, when they found out that hundreds and thousands and millions of people were dying, how did we make it over? How did we keep on sustaining? How did we keep on serving? How did we keep on worshiping? How did we keep on praying? How did we keep on moving? How did we do it? Well, we got to remember there's a memorial. And my brothers and my sisters, I thank God I want to have a memorial. And Renee can look back and say, yeah, Bethesda,
church. Yeah, the folk over on Brown Street, they continue to worship the Lord. They continue to do the work of the ministry. They did not stop. They trusted him. We got some stones of remembrance. The picture in the memorial is in verse 7. Joshua set up 12 stones in the midst of the Jordan, in the place where the feet of the priests bearing the ark of the covenant. See, you got to remember, sister. We got to remember, because a lot of times we forget. We so easily forget. That's why we have a communion table out here. Do this in remembrance of me. Don't forget how he hung bled and the body was bruised every first Sunday, but we ought to remember it. It's a picture of faithfulness. It's a picture of a faithful people. We need that same kind of monument. It don't necessarily have to be a physical monument, but it can, but something remind us. Write it down, something remember how God brought us. And I get ready to go to my seat. That's why I tell, you know, we had the Des Moines Manor here some years back, and Des Moines Manor, we did some good work for some young men. About 12, 13 young men came through there, and we were able to minister to them. And although the building burned down, but we got back here in our room over here, there's a room that has Des Moines Manor on it. Every time I go by there, I remember it. And then we still got the property up there. Keep the property up there because it's a reminder of what God did. Not only did he bless us with the manor, but remember what God did when we didn't have any money that we bought the property. And not only did we didn't have any money, we bought it, but then when we had a mortgage, he paid it off. That's a stone of remembrance. So if he did it before, he'll do it again. I promise you, I'm about to quit here. Last year, a little over a year ago, and I said, we need to increase our digital footprint. Shout out to Pastor Rudd. He and his wife are celebrating 4 years. Amen, if you're watching, Reverend. Happy anniversary. But he was stood here, Pastor Rudd, Jermaine Rudd, and I spoke and I said, Lord, we got to increase our digital footprint, and we want to also improve our interactive worship in the sanctuary. And I said, that's going to cost some money. And I said, I don't know where the money is coming from, but I'm not worried about that because I know God's going to do it. Reverend Rudd stood up here when there was no monitor up here. And he stood here one Sunday morning. He told everybody to look up at the monitor, the scripture on the monitor. And everybody was looking up, and I looked up myself. I said, what is he talking about? He must have thought we put some monitors up here. But he said he was speaking it into existence. And so these monitors are a stone of remembrance. If he did it before, he'll do it again. Start speaking some stuff. Start following God, being commitment and consistent in your walk with God, and watch God go to work. Come on, stand to your feet as we extend this invitation. Jesus hung, bled, and died on a hill called Calvary. Over 2 years ago, 2,000 years ago, he died, but he didn't stay dead. He got up with all power, heaven and earth is in his hands. And because he got up with all power, heaven and earth is in his hand, you can face tomorrow. You can cross your Jordan. But the first thing you got to do is you got to receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. You got to receive Jesus Christ. And so if you're here this morning, if you're watching by way of Facebook or YouTube, and you've been listening, if you've been worshiping with us, we want to invite you to get to know this God that we're talking about. The God that you heard about, how he's a burden bearer, how he's a heavy load sharer, how he's Jehovah Jireh, God our provider, how he is a Jehovah Rapha, the God our healing. He's Jehovah Shalom, he's your peace. And we want to right now lead you in a sinner's prayer. If you don't know Jesus, I'm going to pray with you. You believe, say, Jesus, come into my life right now. Save me, Lord. I believe what you said in your word in John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have an everlasting life. Lord, I receive your salvation. I receive what you did on Calvary. And because I receive it, I'm entering into your peace and your, God, all of what you have for me. Thank you, Lord, for saving me. Thank you, Lord. I receive it right now. I receive that I'm not worried about going to a place prepared for the devil and his angels. I'm going to be with you, Lord. Thank you for saving me. Friends, if you prayed this simple prayer, you just got saved. Now I want you to get in a Bible-believing church. We'd love to have you part of this fellowship known as Bethesda. We're a church that is Christ-led, Bible-fed. Our Christian courage is contagious, and we believe we love to link up with you. We're not a perfect church, but we serve a perfect Savior. And so next time, I want to remind you a few of our services and I said on earlier. If you'd like to come and be a part of our Tell Us Sunday School, which also every Sunday morning at 9 o'clock, also led by Reverend Marilyn J. Peoples, or if you want to call into our prayer line, we'd love to have you. The number to call is 1-605-562-0400. 1-605-562-0400. The access code is 904-9631-pound. Again, 1-605-562-0400. The access code is 904-9631-#pound. Now, you can use that same number to call into our Call to God prayer on Wednesday or our daily prayer every morning at 5 a.m. You call in at 5 a.m., just mute your phone, and prayer will be going on from 5 a.m. to 5:30. That's 7 days a week. We also invite you to support us. If you'd like to support us through online giving, you can do that through GiveLaFly, the free app, or you can also do it through Cash App. Bethesda, dollar sign in the front, Bethesda MBCLR. And then certainly, whatever amount that you give, no amount is too small. And certainly, obviously, no amount is too great. But we love to have you, we'll pray with you, inbox us. You can send our address, 1316 Brown Street, Little Rock, Arkansas, 72204, Bethesda, MBCLR. Until next time, go with God, and he will certainly go with you. God bless you and God keep you is our prayer. Sign off. Amen. 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 We are now off the air. We're going to go ahead and worship through giving at this time. So get your gifts out. Amen. As we worship through giving. Amen. We're going to worship through giving. Amen. We thank God for, again, our friend and brother, Pastor Leroy Mitchell, for being here from New York. Amen. Amen. Look forward. He said he's going to be around here for a while, so I might get a chance to have him to come and share a word if he's around here long enough. Amen. Right here at Bethesda House. Amen. Amen. We also, as we prepare to give, we have want to acknowledge that we have our members who will continue to give online, and some will just drop it off. It's Brother Woodrow Coates. Brother Randolph brought his gift and his tithe back, and so we're glad that he brought his back. And then yesterday, we're out here, Sister Melinda Johnson, she brought her tithe back. And then we have a special gift to our